Hi, everyone. I'd like to start off with a question. How many of you actually feel this way when you start learning a new language or when you come across something new in general? Do you feel things can get confusing? You wonder how do you go about learning things? Do you have a feeling that there are too many resources out there in the community? And say if you're learning a new programming language, and to top that up, if you're even learning a new programming paradigm, how do you go about approaching things? Things can get overwhelming when there are too many resources out there in the community. So do you feel confused? Can I see a show of hands? How many of you feel it can get overwhelming? Great, more than 50%. Right. That was basically my feeling too. And so the journey of going from not knowing something to knowing something has its own ups and downs, has its own highs and lows. And learning a new language can be thrilling. At the same time, it can get uncomfortable. It can get challenging, and it can also be fun. So this talk is basically about my journey of learning Elixir and what helped me learn Elixir better. And hopefully, through this talk, I would be able to give you some takeaways that could help you learn Elixir better. So a bit about me. I work at MoneySmart, and I'm just going to talk to you about my overall journey of learning Elixir so far. So to start with, I started learning Elixir by looking up the basic theoretical resources out there. I started off with Dave Thomas's book. He's a pretty famous guy in the community. If you don't know him, he's well known for the for his contribution to Ruby and introducing Ruby in the United States. His book explains things pretty well when you want to learn individual concepts and how do you apply those concepts with respect to one or two data structures. But after a point of time, I felt my learning was lacking in terms of me being able to apply those concepts in the real world. That's when I went to the official Getting Started Guides of Elixir. So this is basically how it looks. And it's pretty interesting that when you're having a language that you want to learn, and that's being supported by official guides. This is something which was really helpful to me when I wanted to learn Elixir. And the good thing about these guides was that they were concise and to the point. So it made my learning journey much more easier. And after a point, I was like this user on a forum called Elixir Forum, which is a forum that is built on top of Discourse. It's kind of similar to Stack Overflow, but not the same. So this guy says that I was OK with starting off with programming Elixir. And it was very it was interesting theoretically, but I couldn't find the real world connect. What do I do? That's when I thought of learning by doing. And why learning by doing? It was an easier way for me to understand and grasp things. It had a closer connect to real world problems. And learning multiple concepts at one time is something what we usually do or what we usually apply in our day-to-day job when we actually have to solve a particular requirement. And yeah, the whole idea is the more I do, the more I understand, and it's more easy for me to relate back. So learning by doing is very helpful in this way. And so when I was like learning by doing, I wanted to have certain goals with learning by doing approach. They were, I wanted to be more confident. What do I learn is something I should be able to use when I am actually applying them to a real world problem or a real world project. And I wanted to make sure that I was approaching problem solving using the new language in the right way. I also wanted to make sure that I'm applying the right concepts to solve the given problem. Also, I want to be able to track and make progress in general. Well, as a beginner, you would want to make sure that you're heading in the right direction. How do you do that is something which can be questionable, or it's not easily answerable because you're starting off and you don't have any guidance. And that's something I wanted to see how I could better keep an eye off. In addition to that, I wanted to learn the underlying concepts with real-world problems, because I could establish the connect much better that way. And I want to write idiomatic Elixir code, which basically means using some of the best practices and the right constructs or structures to a particular problem that I want to solve. Also, the ability to apply multiple concepts, and I want to see how I could improve with my learning along the way. So that's where I think if I could compare my solution with somebody else's solution, I could find missing gaps and potentially areas of improvement. So the way I went about approaching this was through collaboration in general. And I felt like if I learned things in a collaborative way, it would help me learn things much more faster and it would make learning even more fun. How did I do that? One of the platforms that I made use of was Exercism. So what's useful about Exercism, if you see what's been highlighted over here, is they help you with some kind of small problems that basically bridge the gap between a real-world problem and what you learn from a book in sense of its theoretical concepts. And it gives you some small wins that can actually help you get a better grasp of those concepts so that you are more confident to apply them in the real world. And in addition to that, I also made use of a couple of forums, like Elixir Forum, which is built on top of Discourse. And Discourse has been built by Jeff Atwood, who's a co-founder of Stack Overflow. And that's pretty famous in the programming community. In addition to that, I also made use of another platform where through Slack, I could, again, communicate with different people in the community to get their help on a more instantaneous way. The good thing about forums like the Elixir Forum was they have a very strong focus of supporting beginners. So that was encouraging to me, and that's basically what I wanted, or I think what anybody else would want when they want to start learning a new language. So the way I went about solving things from there on was the classical introductory exercise with Elixir, or with any language, which is the Hello World exercise. So if you see over here on the right-hand side, you have the way things work in Exercism, just to give introduction, is you have a failing test case that you have to make pass, and you have a basic sample script on your, as you can see on the left, and the idea is to write the minimum code that you need to make the failing test case pass. So this was my initial solution. So the whole problem was, given a module and a function called hello, I need to print out hello world. And the way I approached it was by using something called as default arguments, where if I want to print hello Alice, I can just pass hello world.hello, and I can add Alice as an argument to that function call. And with that, I would get hello Alice. And if I don't pass any particular name, by default, it'll take the word world. And that's basically, I wanted to implement it in a way which is more flexible. So that's why I went with the default arguments approach. When I started learning this, I actually was trying to look up, how do I implement default arguments in Elixir? Things weren't very clear to me when I read the documentation. A particular aspect of the documentation made this thing a little confusing for me. So as a beginner, when I was looking at the documentation, it had an io.putS and the string hello. I was like, when we want to use default arguments, I just need a default argument. Why would I need io.putS, which is like a printS or a putS in other languages, which basically prints something to your console. And that's where I went to the Elixir website related GitHub repo. And I opened up an issue where I thought of clarifying this with the collaborators there. And I basically proposed to them that, hey, instead of using the default arguments documentation with io.putS, you can use it without that. And that's when I had a conversation with Jose Valim, who's the creator of Elixir. He replied saying that the original intention of why it was added was to help you understand the evaluation of default arguments, at when exactly do they get evaluated. And he realized that, yes, it could be more confusing than helpful to a beginner. And that's where he said, like, yeah, let's remove it. And that was my first PR as a beginner learning the language with just a very simple exercise, hello world. That's how I started with my first contributions to open source with the Elixir language. And it was a very fun experience because I was just starting off and it just gave me some good confidence to make make further progress with learning the language. The next exercise that I would like to talk about is exercise called GigaSecond. So the way this works is the problem statement for this exercise is given a particular date, like if you see over here, it's 16, 13, 1977. if I add 10 power 9 seconds to it, I need the resultant date in the same format as the initial input of 6/13/1977. So 10 power 9 seconds is like 31.7 years. And so a bit of more background about me. I've been coding with an object-oriented programming background for a number of years. So my initial approach to the solution was, okay, let me convert the date time, which is 6/13/1977, to seconds. Then let me add a gigasecond to it, which you can see is 10 power 9 seconds. And then let me convert the sum back to date time. And that was my initial approach. And I was making use of saving things into variables. And this was, it worked for me. The solution was fine. It passed all test cases for me. Then what happened was I was comparing my solutions with other people's solutions on exorcism. And that's when I realized that in the functional world, you don't necessarily make use of variables. Instead, you can use something called as pipes. What are pipes? Pipes are a way of passing data around from one line of code to another line of code through something called as transformations. And that's where I learned that when I'm learning a new language and also probably learning a new paradigm, I should learn to unlearn whatever I already know from the old paradigm so that I can open my mind to relearning this in another way of problem solving. And that's basically when it left an impression on me that, okay, going forward, I will be more proactive about using such things like pipe and thinking more functionally than in a more imperative way of problem solving. And yeah, that was a takeaway for me from this exercise. And in addition to that, I also learned how to use a particular constant in another fashion. So instead of just directly using 10 power 9, as you can see in the code over here, we could use a math.power function. And so my overall learnings from just one exercise were, I learned how to use pipe operator. I also learned how to use the constant in different ways. One more learning that I had from this exercise was, so what happens is when you're trying to convert something, or basically when you're trying to do something, and if you can't find the solution for it in the Elixir documentation, that's when you can look up the documentation of Erlang. Why? Because Elixir is built on top of Erlang. So instead of directly going and getting your solutions from people's help on forums, one thing that you could do initially is start with Elixir documentation, move on with the Erlang documentation, and actually the whole date time to Gregorian seconds function is taken from the Erlang documentation. And that's what I also learned, that, hey, this is what I can additionally do whenever I'm stuck. And I also learned how to use the Erlang code within Elixir code this way. Moving on, I had one more exercise that I solved. It's an exercise about a person called Bob. Bob is like a lackadaisical teenager, and his responses are basically in four ways. He responds, sure, if you ask him a question. He responds, whoa, chill out, if you yell at him. And he also responds, fine, be that way, if you address him without actually saying anything, which is like being silent. And he answers, whatever, if you talk to him about anything else. So when I was solving this particular problem, one of the test cases that I was dealing with was given an input. So somebody's talking to Bob in Russian, and the answer it should evaluate against is the yelling answer. So if somebody's shouting to him in Russian, if you look back at the problem statement, the answer should be, whoa, chill out. And that's when like somebody's yelling at him. And how do you actually go about getting to write the code which passes this particular test case was something tricky to me, because I had more of an English background, and I wasn't sure what is capitals or what is not capitals in Russian. And it was a little tricky to me. And so I was stuck for a while, and I was looking up for solutions. And that's where, again, I found Elixir Forum to be very helpful to me. Turns out another guy also had a similar question. He also asked about this particular problem that he stuck with getting the talking in capitals test case to pass. And he was wondering, how do I get my way around solving this problem? So turns out the way this works is I was able to actually find a solution to this problem using a regex. And I was just looking up this whole question and the conversation around this question in terms of the response that he got for to where he was stuck. One thing in particular that struck me was this particular exercise's approach by this user. Another user who basically commented on telling him that you can solve this better was to understand if something is in capitals. What you basically can do is you can find a solution without using regex. And how? It basically is a combination of using these two particular functions and these two comparisons. So string.upcase, so if you see over here, this is the given Russian string. What I do is, if I do an upcase of the string, if I get the same result, well, that's one way of telling me that the given string is upcase. In addition to that, since it's Russian, I'm not very clear if everything is already upcase because I don't know Russian. And I wanted to see that, okay, what is the result do I get if I downcase it? And the result that I got from this was actually with some characters downcased. Okay, this is when I realized that, yeah, okay, this is how downcase looks in Russian. And yeah, the downcase of the input should not be same as the original input. That will a combination of both these conditions will actually tell me that, yes, this particular thing is in upcase. That's basically a solution to the problem that really got me intrigued because it didn't make use of regex and it was much more clearer and easier to read. So this is basically my same experience where I was having some regex code and I felt my code was not that readable. So I was looking at more from a perspective of somebody else who will look at my solution and see if they're able to understand it. I felt replacing the regex with the upcase and the downcase combination and the upcase combination comparison checks was very helpful. And this came through Elixir forum. So it was pretty helpful that I could find something similar in that platform. And in addition to that, I had more learnings. When I was looking up other people's solutions, because exercism gives you that potential of, you know, finding ways how you can improve your code by seeing other people's solutions. One of the other things that I found was this whole concept of type specs. Now in Elixir, type specs are basically a way of doing some kind of static checking for your types or for your data. So if for a given function, whatever you see as in it is something on addition to that is a given line above your function prototype, which starts with the word at spec. So why are type specs useful? It probably can help you determine whether you're returning what is the type that you're returning with respect to a particular function. And I felt coming from a object-oriented background, this is probably more code for me to maintain. And I would not really want to do that. And that's when I realized I should probably explore more. Why do people even use type specs in Elixir? So it just got me curious to dig further. And I was just trying to find answers on Slack. So in the Elixir lang Slack, we have a beginner's channel, which has more than 2,700 users. And that's when I actually opened up a question about why to use type specs and what is the big deal. So one of the answers that people gave was, it's a good first thought when you're considering to change a particular function. Now, I didn't think about it that way, but the fact that you can know what a function returns at my first sight without actually looking at the code was something that got me very interested because it saves me the whole time of looking at the whole function in more detail to understand what's happening within it. And turns out it also is helpful in terms of reading libraries documentation. And that's where somebody is trying to ask for the same question, like, why should I use type specs? Because it can help you understand code much more better. So the whole thing of finding other people's solutions, trying to see what made the solutions better, and also the fact that trying to understand why type specs are really useful in Elixir made me more curious and ask people for more answers. And that's where Slack was useful. And what have I ended up learning from this experience? I even wrote a blog about this so that people who have similar questions can also get answers on why to use type specs. So that was something that was a good takeaway for me from the whole experience of learning so many things just from another exercise of exercism. And pretty helpful as a beginner because, again, getting clarity for these things might not be obvious because I was not even able to find these answers in the online documentation. So turns out, like, even if you are in that situation where you're not able to find answers for certain questions on documentation, you can try to get answers more faster through forums like Slack. So this is how my final solution looked like. It is modularized more. It's much more cleaner compared to my previous solutions. And for me to even get there, I refer to some more people's solutions. And this made my code more abstract in the sense it's much more reusable if people want to use. And that's one thing I really like about exercism is that it really stretches you to think further about how much more you can improve your code. Moving on, I had one more exercise that I solved, which is a word count exercise. The whole idea of this exercise is, given a phrase, I want to count the number of occurrences of a particular word within that phrase, and I want to repeat that for all the words in that phrase. So what was my initial thought process of approaching this problem was, think of it as like a hash, and where the key will be word, and the value will be the number of occurrences of that word. So I was thinking about approaching this in the form of, okay, I should be able to create a hash, and within that hash, I should have words as keys, and I should be able to loop them throughout the string such that I break them as a word delimiter, and I increment the count as and when I encounter the same word again. So the question was, how do I approach this in the functional world? Because turns out, when you do want to do this in a normal imperative way, you want to save the previous state of the result of, say, calculating the occurrences of, say, the first word, and you want to add up to that. But in the functional world, you can't mutate the state of a variable. So how do I go about doing it in the functional world was a question to me. And that's when I realized that there is an enumerable model, for example, in the Ruby world. And I realized I should draw parallels between what I've learned in another language and apply, or just even look out if I can apply that kind of thinking, like, will there be an enumerable module in Elixir? And that was something I wanted to explore next in terms of how I wanted to approach this particular problem. This was one of the test cases that basically shows you that, okay, for a given text, this is how the result should look like. So in the functional world, because you can't mutate state, even if you're looping through a particular structure, like a map, and adding the count to it is not straightforward. That's where things can get, again, tricky for you, because we are used to thinking and solving this in a procedural way or a way which is not, which is basically saving stuff to state. And since you can't save stuff to state in Elixir, I was not sure how to proceed. And turns out this somebody posted about this as a question on Stack Overflow, and they wanted to, again, do something similar. The whole idea was they wanted to given a set of RSS feeds, they want to update the RSS feeds, and they want to update the RSS feeds to historic data. So how do they do that was their question. And turns out the answer was given by Jose for this question, and he suggested that people need to make use of a reduce function in Elixir. So the way the reduce function works is basically, so this is a particular function body, right? So the result of the previous function, so the result of this particular function is used as an accumulator, which basically means a structure that in which you can add more stuff. And that accumulator will be like, let's say this is your accumulator. This accumulator can be used when you iterate to the next item, which will be 2. So that's how you basically add on and see the count with respect to each particular element of the list. So this was something which was not very obvious for me from the documentation. And the Stack Overflow answer here really helped me to understand how does reduce work better in Elixir. And as you can see, Jose has mentioned very clearly, the map at the end will still be empty because we can't mutate data structures in the functional world. So that's why we had to use reduce. And this is how reduce can be helpful when you're dealing with similar problems. And that's where, again, I raised another PR. This was on the Elixir core repo. And I said that, hey, this was not very obvious about how does reduce work, and can we make it more clear? And it was accepted by Jose. And so that turns out, like, you know, these are basically how I ended up finding gaps as a beginner, and how I ended up feeling that, okay, if it's not very clear, let's try to make it clear for the people who will end up using this in the future. So also, in addition to this, in Ruby world, for example, there is a particular there's a particular service called Hound, which basically gives you code review comments on your pull requests. Something similar to that is a service called Urbert by Platforma Tech, where Jose works, and he's one of the founders there. And they have a service through which they go through your pull requests and they comment to you what can be improved in your code using a style guide. So the static analysis tool that is used for giving you style improvements in your code is a tool called Credo in the Elixir world. And Urbert integrates with Credo to give you feedback on how you can improve your code. So as a beginner, the more resources or the more help you can get to improve your code is something that everybody looks out for. And that's where I realized that in addition to using Exorcism, in addition to using Elixir Forum, in addition to using Slack, I can also make use of Urbert to give me feedback on how I can improve my code and write more idiomatic Elixir. So yeah, collaboration with bots, that's possible. So now I took a step back. I've made decent progress. I learned a lot from a few exercises, but turns out in Exorcism, there are 89 problems. And with 89 problems, if I go about solving each and every problem, it takes me a lot of time. And I wouldn't have so much time to actually learn solve all these problems and learn the language and then end up actually applying them in my real world projects. I want to learn faster. And that was something I was got me curious as to how can I end up learning things faster. That's when I realized that in one discussion in the Elixir track, they have a good mapping of what particular exercise that you want to learn and what are the concepts that you can learn through each exercise. Now, this was very helpful to me because I wanted to proceed. I don't want to solve the same problems which make me, again, familiar with concepts that I already have a better understanding of. For me, the next target was I wanted to learn pattern matching. I want to learn recursion. So I started off with taking the sublist exercise. And that's the last problem I'd like to talk to you about. This is a problem which really got me thinking about functional programming in more depth. So I chose this exercise because it would teach me two things. One was pattern matching and one was recursion. And that's why I thought of taking a deep dive into solving this. So the way the problem statement for this exercise, as you can see, one and two, you have to determine if the first list is contained within the second, or the second is contained within the first, or whether both are contained within each other, or if none of these are true. That was the given problem statement. And how I approached this problem, my initial thought process for solving this was, hey, this looks like sets. Let me see if I can find a subset function in Elixir. And turns out there is a subset function in Elixir, and that is with a library function called mapset. And if I use mapset.subset, I can find whether a given list is a subset of another list. Now, that worked for me pretty well, except for one test case, which was this test case. If you observe closely in this particular, so they have an interactive shell in Elixir where I try to execute the same code as per the test case using the same list values. And turns out it returns true. But what is expected from the test case is it should return unequal. So my code was in such a way that if it returns true, it should be returning equal, whereas if it returns false, it should return unequal. But since it was returning true, it was returning equal, and what I wanted was unequal. So it made me realize that the way mapset's subset function works, it does not take into account the order of the items, or it does not take into account duplicate items. So what it basically means is that if I have 1, 2, and 1, 2, 3, it will look for something. So as for the problem statement, if it has to be a sublist, I need 1, 2, 1, 2, 3 for it to be a sublist of the bigger list. But I have 1, 2, 3, 1, 2 instead of 1, 2, 1, 2, 3. So that's why unequal. So I was like, nah, subset doesn't work for me. I have to try something else. And that's when I basically went about looking at, thinking about, hey, I have two lists. I can find the difference between two lists. Even in sets, I can subtract one set from the other. And that's how I can see if I can find the difference between two lists or if one is a sublist of another through the difference operator. This didn't work for me for two particular test cases. One of them was a recurring values unequal test case, and the other one was a test case where a huge sublist was not in another huge sublist. That particular test case, when I ran it against this solution, which made use of the difference operator, was taking too long to execute, and that made me realize that I should probably stop this and just think about it, because it was not really helping me. And instead of one, now I have two test cases failing. Why the difference operator doesn't work? If you see on the right-hand side, it basically shows you that the difference between one element and the difference, the way it works is on a per element basis and not against the entire list as a whole. So one against one, it can be strike through, similarly for two. But since three cannot be strike through against one, which is the smaller sublist, I'm left with 3-2, 3-2-1. And that's where I realized that, okay, this approach doesn't work for me. What happened next was I was stuck. I had the feeling of the imposter syndrome, where I was stuck and I was not sure how do I proceed. And I was just thinking, am I not able to solve this? Am I not thinking in the right way? How do I proceed? Things weren't very clear to me, and I was looking for some guidance or some direction. How did I proceed? So I submitted my solution on exorcism, and as I was exploring some other people's solutions, I was mainly reading their comments. I wasn't actually looking at the solution, because for me, I didn't want to see people's solutions. I wanted to see what people were saying in their comments about solving this exercise. Turns out there's another guy on exorcism who had the same problem with one of the test cases which I was not able to make pass, which was a huge sublist is not in a huge list. And that's basically nothing but this particular test case. So two huge sublists, you're comparing this thing like on a element by element basis, and that can take a hell lot of time to determine if one. So basically I'm comparing the whole list against a length, against the other sublist to see if they're actually, if one is a sublist of the other. Well, so he asked the same question in his solution. He submitted a solution which did not fully work, and he got a hint from somebody. So the guy who gave the hint took a very small example. Let's take two lists, right? B and A. Now we have to check whether the list B is whether a subset of list A. So you'll compare 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 against a similar list which has at least 5 elements. Well, that's when you can find whether it's an equal list or a sublist, right? So I would compare 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 against 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. No, if it's not a sublist, you move on. You compare 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 against the next set of items, which is 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Now, as soon as you compare 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 against 4, 5, 6, 7, stop. You realize that you're comparing a list A, which has got 5 elements, against a list which has got 4 elements. That's when it was like a aha moment for me. Like, as long as length B is greater than A, proceed with your comparison. As long as length B is not greater than A, stop. Because there's no point comparing 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 against 5, 6, 7, 6, 7, and 7. Because you already know that it is not a sublist by now. And that's where the hint was very helpful to me. And I applied the hint to my solution, and I was able to get an answer without actually seeing somebody else's solution. It just gave me more confidence that, hey, it's okay if you're stuck. And I took another step back, and I just had some reflections from this. I asked myself, did I try honestly? And did I try to find ways to get unstuck? Was I fast enough at getting unstuck? And did I identify missing gaps between my thought process and somebody else's thought process to solve the problem? And I also realized a bigger thing, which was not very obvious to me, was it's okay to ask for hints in exorcism in addition to asking for help. And you don't necessarily have to see somebody else's solution. You can still hold on to your confidence, just ask for hints. And so this again, where they talk about imposter syndrome, there was an article by a person called Alisa Liu, and she basically says, what I know is definitely a small subset of the entire universe. And learning to program is hard. And learning anything worthwhile is hard when you're starting out. And that's just reality. That's not imposter syndrome. How many of us actually think about it to that much depth? So it also helped me realize that there was a missing debugging chapter in the Elixir documentation. And very recently, I proposed to the guys on the website, or the main collaborators of the platform, that, hey, we're missing a documentation chapter on the Getting Started guides. And I'm currently working on adding some documentation there so that people can get up and running with Elixir much more faster. This also made me realize a few, and one more thing, how to be a better programmer. If you see over here, this is one solution to sublist, where a guy is suggesting that you have a given function called includes, and you're basically trying to check if one string or like one list is included within another list. And what he was suggesting was, in the string documentation of Elixir, they have a function called contains. Well, when you're trying to check if a list is within another list, you can also use the same function name contains instead of using the word includes. Why do that? Well, just think about it, right? If your function names that you write in your custom code, if that is very similar to the actual standard documentation, it makes things much more easier for you to remember and actually apply in your real-world problems. Well, think about more complex custom names with respect to functions, right? They're hard to make use of, and it basically involves looking back. Whereas if you're using standard, if you're using function names which are very similar to standard function names, it makes it much more easier for somebody to think about it without actually somebody looking up as to what the method can do for you, and it basically ends up saving you time. So, and this is something you can apply across any programming language, that your function names, if they're as good as standard function names, they're much more easier to use and to recall whenever you need to use them. So that was like a high level learning for me. And basically, even comparing my solution to other people's solutions helped me learn how to write better Elixir code. And this is actually somebody else's solutions. He has done 6 iterations to this particular problem. And if you see, each of the iterations has got a lot of comments. And this is something I would encourage you to check up whenever you get some free time. And that's the beauty of exorcism, right? That collaboration is something that they promote. And they promote you to go and share your ideas with everybody. So this is how my final solution looked like. I had 5 iterations to solving this problem. And through each iteration, I commented whatever I learned and what was my approach. So that was pretty helpful to me. And so to wrap up, basically what I realized was the Elixir forum is very helpful when you want to post a question or just get unstuck. And they have so many categories. They have categories with respect to getting started, learning resources, libraries, even the Phoenix framework, and also something specific to deployment testing, et cetera. In addition to that, since if you're a beginner to Elixir, you just see that people have asked questions like, how do I proceed learning the language, and how do I get better at it? So you'll really find quite a few interesting insights on how did other people approach the language. So the whole point is that the language is using state-of-the-art tools like Discourse to help you get started with learning a new language. And that's what really makes learning even more fun, when you're able to get unstuck faster and you're able to get help. And even for the Elixir Lang Slack, they have so many channels where you can actually get help. They have channels for testing, they have channels for beginners, they have channels for the Phoenix framework, they have channels even for Ecto, which is a persistence layer used in Elixir, and a lot of other channels that you can basically make use of to find specific answers to specific questions. And turns out, in many of these channels, there are even core contributors to those libraries who will be there to probably help you out and help you get unstuck. So something that really helped me was the beginners channel, so I would definitely encourage you to check it out. And I realized recently, as I was researching more about this, Robert Wording, who's the creator of Erlang, spoke about one thing. When he was learning Erlang, or basically when he was actually giving courses on Erlang or Elixir, he found 3 things that people get stuck with when they learn the language. One of them is immutable data, one of them is pattern matching, and one of them is recursion. So I'm glad I solved the sublist exercise because it helped me understand recursion and pattern matching better. So the whole idea of relating the concepts you want to learn to an exercise was something that really worked well for me, because I didn't really have to solve 89 problems to understand these concepts. Because at the end of the day, we all want to learn something fast enough so that we can actually be able to apply them in real world projects, because that's how we feel we are actually productive, right? That's when we really feel we get the real experience. So doing specific exercises and doing small exercises really helped me along the way. Next steps, how you can go about proceeding with learning. you can definitely use exorcism as one of the ways of solving problems. But yes, please note, it's very important that you post conversations, you have conversations on the platform to really benefit from your experience of solving problems on that platform. Because without the conversations, I've seen many people end up submitting their solutions, but they don't get feedback. And it's also important for you to give feedback. So if you even start a conversation with, okay, these are the problems I encountered, and this is how I solved the problem, or this was my approach. If anybody can guide me on how to solve this part, people who will actually even review your solution will know that you have given them enough context. I mean, think about it, right? If somebody back then did not go and comment how that person was stuck and how that person got unstuck, and somebody did not see that, I would still remain stuck with learning those concepts, and I would still look around for finding solutions. And mentorship is something which is not easy to get. So if you can get mentorship this way, make the most of it. Other ways of learning the language, I think you can use Advent of Code, which is something that you do once a year. And somebody just posted on the Advent of Code channel in Elixir Language Hack. They were able to understand streams better through solving some of the exercises there. And that got this guy excited. And he went about saying that, OK, I'm going to go and solve some exercises from Advent of Code. I feel it's OK to use Advent of Code as a platform to learn the language. But if you're starting off, I think this is like the next level, because the whole mapping of concepts to exercises is not very clear with Advent of Code, I think. And in addition to that, you can use Elixir Cones. Dave Thoms also has another course on Elixir for Programmers. It's an online course which gives you hands-on training on how to use Elixir. And somebody has even mentioned that it's a good way to learn Elixir, and they've had good experience of learning things that way. So another takeaway for me was the whole idea of learning, unlearning, and relearning. And that's where I realized that if you're a programmer who's coming from a different background, it's important to think about things in another way. And that's where you have to probably be more conscious and mindful about your habits in terms of problem solving. Like I did in the case of the exercise, which made me realize that I don't have to use variables, like in the gigasecond exercise. And contributing to documentation has its own value. Jose Valim encourages people to contribute to documentation. He's mentioned that over here. And I think that's basically, there's even a guy who's giving a talk at a conference of Elixir called MPEX Los Angeles in 2018. And he also highlights one point, that the docs can play the gap between a beginner and an expert, and providing everyone a way of getting unstuck and understanding things better. I mean, just think about it, right? If the documentation was not clear enough, even as a beginner, you don't feel like continuing with learning a language. So the fact that you're making contributions to the documentation is having a much more bigger impact than you can imagine. The power of collaborative learning. The whole idea of even collaborating passively, where I didn't have people answering questions to me at a given point of time, did not stop me from learning. If you see, this whole conversation goes back to 2014. Somebody saw this in 2014. But they made a very conscious attempt of actually commenting about their approach and what they learned along the way. That has helped me 3 years further down the line. And I'm thankful to them, because without that, I would still be stuck with learning a few concepts in the language. So collaborate with learning a language. And the community is very approachable to beginners. Do small things, like how life is about small wins and celebrating them. Doing the small problems gives you the confidence to make sure that you're progressing in the right direction. And yeah, be proactive about your conversations on the platform. Make use of hints. Also believe in yourself that, yeah, you can do much more than just actually learning the language. You can even give back to open source. And yeah, well, giving back to open source is actually boosting adoption of Elixir. So you're playing a much bigger role than you can imagine, than you can think of. And yes, collaboration can be passive as well. And even collaborative learning through a passive way can give you good ways to make progress. And to sum up, I would like to talk about one more thing. Through the exorcism platform, and basically even through collaborative learning, one thing I realized was, how do I be a better problem solver? Because if you see, this guy asked one question with respect to the Bob exercise. He says that, but it's how that conclusion was reached that truly interests me. So at the end of the day, we want to be better at language, but we also want to be better problem solvers, because that will even help us back in our work. And that's where, you know, collaborative learning and using platforms like exorcism, where you can compare solutions, can really help you. And to sum up, also, I would like to mention this one thing. Always have a beginner's mindset, because the potential that you have as a beginner can be sometimes much more than what you can have as an expert. Benjamin Tan, who's a local Singaporean, and he's written a book about the Elixir and the OTP guidebook. I found this in one of his blogs where he was again talking about the same thing. Being a beginner is precious, and celebrate it. And it definitely can help you make a much bigger impact than you can imagine. Because with a beginner's mindset, you have fresh ideas and you can always explore your potential much more and imagine the possibilities are much more than what you can imagine. So, yeah, that's pretty much about it. I would like to thank Anil for some feedback on the slides, and that's about it. Feel free to keep in touch if you'd like to. And any questions? Yes, please.
Can you actually tell us why you started learning it?
Yeah, sure. So I had language, I had knowledge with, so I started off with learning C back in my undergraduate degree. And So I started with learning C in my undergraduate degree, and I proceeded with learning a little bit of Java, and I got into Ruby programming in the professional world. I was just casually exploring stuff as a programmer and trying to figure out why are people excited about languages in general? Or how do people keep learning new things? Because I mean, we know as a person in general, I realized learning is a good way to keep yourself up to speed. And for me, like, even people were talking about things like functional imperative, I was like, what are all these concepts? I don't know what they are. And that's where I wanted to explore further. So your question was, why did I want to learn Elixir specifically?
Yeah, for example, Elixir specifically, or whatever other languages
are. Sure. So I chose Elixir specifically because, first of all, I had knowledge from an object-oriented background. I knew how to write procedural code. I want to learn about writing things in another style. Why? Because there was one quote on Twitter where somebody was saying that if you're not thinking about how you're problem solving, you're probably not learning enough to the right language. And that's where I realized that maybe I should just think about learning it from another approach. I mean, just imagine, right, whatever we apply in our daily life, if we just start thinking about things from somebody else's perspective, it opens up our mind. And that's pretty much true even in the case of programming. I'm confident about writing procedural code. I'm confident about writing imperative code. I'm confident about writing object-oriented code. But what are the benefits of writing functional code? That was something that got me curious. Why was the hype around this?
So why Elixir over like?
Yeah. Okay. Yeah, sure. So Elixir had a Ruby-like syntax, the Ruby community is very famous for being very developer-friendly, and people like Jose Valim have come from the Ruby community, where he has been like a core contributor. And so the syntax is kind of similar, and the community is very supportive. Also, one more thing that I realized is in the Elixir community, Jose Valim is very closely involved in not only Elixir projects, but also projects related to the Phoenix web framework. And that is really helpful, especially when you want to learn things just beyond Elixir. And the fact that he's also ideas and proposals gives me the confidence that I'm proceeding to learn something under a person who's himself very motivated and he's very supportive, and it makes me think I'm thinking about it in the sense of being in somebody's leadership who cares about giving back to the community and who's also challenging the status quo at the same time. Yeah.
Guys, sorry to cut you off.
Yeah.
We'll have the questions to Mohnish after the talk by Nate. Matt, is it fine to?
Yeah, sure. Cool. Thank you very much, everyone.